Proverbs chapter 11, verses 10 to 11. When it goes well with the righteous, the city rejoices. And when the wicked perish, there are shouts of gladness. By the blessings of the upright, a city is exalted. And by the mouth of the wicked, it is overthrown. We're going to spend a few moments in prayer on behalf of our nation and cry out to God for God to save our country from every plan of the enemy. The nation is being attacked spiritually, economically, socially, individually. On every front, the enemy is attacking us with divisiveness. We're going to pray, even as Hezekiah did in the book of 2 Kings, chapter 19, when the king of Assyria came against Israel with a letter. Hezekiah brought the letter in the presence of God and cried and said, "Lord, save Israel from the hands of the Assyrians." So we're going to pray and say, "Lord, save America from the hand of the enemy." Amen. Wherever you're standing, take this moment and pray on behalf of the nation, on behalf of this country. Father, Lord, save us in Jesus' name. Pray, lifting up your life unto God. Every battle that you're going through, lift it up unto God. He's the only one who can fight on our behalf. Lift up your family, your children, your work, every aspect of you. Surrender your life unto God and say, "Father, Lord, this battle that I'm facing, I lift it up unto you. It belongs to you. Fight on my behalf." Pray. Blessed King, Holy One, to you be all honor and praise, to you be all adoration. For your presence in our lives, for your power in our lives, for your grace that has brought us through this week, Even as we stand before your throne, lifting up our nations unto you, lifting up our very own battles unto you. Father, Lord, we cry that you hear us, O God. Heal our land. Lift up your hands and let there be peace over our land in the name of Jesus. Heal any divisiveness that is among us in the name of Jesus. We, your children, are crying out unto you, O God. Save us by your power. For the sake of the righteous, in the name of Jesus, we ask, O God, that you lift up your hands and heal this country. Forgive us our sins. Cleanse us and purify us in your blood, Lord Jesus. We lift up our heart unto you. It belongs to you. Let all our wars and all our battles be fought by you on our behalf. We humble ourselves before you. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. And all of God's children say, Amen. Amen. Let's lift up the name of Jesus.
Nothing can stand against the power of God.
Christ is a solid foundation on which we stand. Our existence, our every life depends solely on Him. If we move away from Him, we will fall. Amen? He's our firm foundation. Let's declare it together.
wants prayer. He wants prayer. No, he won't.
Hallelujah. Amen. Jesus is faithful forever. Amen.
If we build on his firm foundation, he will not fail. Now, we often talk about God's will, but we don't often talk about his won'ts. He won't abandon you. He won't close his ears to your prayer. He won't withhold any good thing from those who walk uprightly. He won't withhold mercy to the repentant. But he will keep his promises, make us stronger, and deepen our relationship with him. That takes a firm foundation. Any contractor can tell you the importance of a good foundation. Without it, fences collapse. Walls in houses develop cracks and even suffer damage during an earthquake. At the end of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus compares hearing and doing his words to building a house on a rock, a firm foundation. But hearing his words and not doing them, or listening to another voice, the world's voice, is like building your house on sand. And that house will be destroyed by the floods and storms of life. Now, even as Christians, we can be distracted and deceived by the world's promises for the future, fame and fortune. But as Solomon says in Ecclesiastes, to put our trust in what this world offers is vain and meaningless, and ultimately unsatisfying. And Jesus adds, it's self-destructive. The Lord has given us more than enough teaching for a firm foundation for our lives, our marriages, our families, even for our nation. The Old Testament teaches us that godly principles are the foundation for a nation. Psalm 11 paints a picture of the wicked aiming arrows to kill the upright in heart. In the darkness that has grown because the foundations have been eroded. The book of James also emphasizes hearing and doing. Both are essential. Failing to do what the Lord commands is inviting destruction into our lives, our marriages, our families, and our nation. But our own strength is not enough to keep God's word. We are too weak. Amen? That was weak. All right. And Jesus is more than a teacher. He is our constant companion with all the riches of heaven as we follow as his disciples. He is yoked together with us to rely on his strength and to find rest. He is the way, the truth, and the life. The only way to be in heaven with the Father. He is the good shepherd who lays down his life for his sheep. And even in grieving our losses, he reminds us he is the resurrection and the life. Eternal life. So he asks us, actually invites us, to put our trust in him, to have faith in him. Now, I define faith in two parts, trust and obey. Trust his promises. Build on them. Obey his commands. That's the doing what we hear part. And as we build our lives on him, he will grow his character within us so that we can love even the unlovable. We can forgive even those who take aim at us. We can pick up our own crosses so that our old selves can die and we can be made new, born again, live in freedom from sin, all the time being shaped by the creator of the universe. So now, in communion, let's remember that good shepherd who laid down his life, the Son of God who left heaven and sacrificed his life in love to redeem us, the Messiah who sets us free through forgiveness and grace, and the King of Kings who conquered sin and death and rose victoriously. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, He blessed it and he gave it to his disciples, his closest companions. He said, "This is my body given for you. Take and eat." And then he took the cup. He said, "This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink." Dear Lord Jesus, we know that you will never fail to keep your promises. So we commit ourselves to follow you and to submit to your building plan, your regulations, even your schedule. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. So it is my pleasure to introduce to you our speaker this morning. He's Dr. Charles Self, but he goes by Charlie, all right? And he lets me call him that too. The biggest accolade I can give is that whenever this man comes, I want to have a meal with him, right? I want to exchange ideas because he's been a college professor. I think he's currently a seminary professor. You know, he's one of the smart ones. But he takes all of this stuff internally and he lets God sift it through God's mind, through God's heart. And now it's entered Charlie's heart to share with us all the goodness of God and the heritage that we have in our Christian faith. So, Dr. Self.
I've been asked to speak about the hand of God in American history, and I'm very, very pleased to be with you. I also want to just extend a greeting to some who might be newer this morning. You've all been invited to meet us after the service and hope you will, but I can just testify to you that this church has been an influence in my life since the 1970s when I first became a Christian. Your commitment to Scripture, your commitment to doing good, your commitment to education and learning, commitment to the community. And there was a wonderful shuttle going back between San Bruno and San Jose for decades of just beautiful teachers and ministries. So Church of the Highlands, thank you. And for those of you newer, you have found a good home. And you found a place where you can ask questions. One of the things that helped me discover a call to be a pastor as well as a teacher was I kept asking questions, and so all of my youth pastors and Sunday school teachers said, "You might want to think about teaching. You have so many questions." And so God's been good over the past decades for Kathy and myself. And I want to also bring greetings from believers from nearly 100 nations that I've been involved with this week at a conference. We had 1,000 people from almost 100 nations. And I had a chance to lead morning prayer services and hear the praises and prayers of God's people from Africa, Asia, Latin America, and from North America as well, and from the islands of the sea. And so again, thank you for representing God's global family. And I'm grateful with you that we're in this free land called the United States of America. Very grateful. But we're also, would you agree with me, we're a nation in need today. We have a lot of confusion and rebellion. We have confusion over identity today, confusion over what it is to be a human being, what it is to be a man or woman made in the image of God. And we have a lot of rebellion against what we would call common sense and normal morality. And I had somebody once say to me, "I don't even know what normal is anymore." I said, just keep the idea and go back to Scripture. We'll find out together. Have you noticed a lot of anger? And a lot of polarization is a fancy word for people kind of getting far apart from each other and not being willing to meet in the middle. We're so quick to label and libel each other. I recently was in my neighborhood just out front doing my lawn, and there's a house next door that was for sale. And so somebody was looking at it, and I thought, oh, I'll be a good neighbor and tell them about the neighborhood. Turned out they were a political person who was canvassing the neighborhood and telling people to vote against this person and for the other. And I thought, well, I'll engage gently because I'm not going to start an argument. But I said, well, I have some different opinions than the person, you know, that you're advocating, but there's a lot we need to do to make our world a better place. Let's work on that together. And within 5 minutes, he called me a despicable human being because I didn't agree with him. And I thought, wow, how many of you know we can disagree with each other and still be friends? But it's been harder and harder to do that in our world. But can I give you good news? Our Lord hears the intercessory prayers of his faithful people. And we've been praying for this nation, and our prayers have been joined by millions of others. And so I want to share the good news of God's work in our history, as well as some of the heartache moments that bring us to our knees, that we can become more like him as we humble ourselves before him. Just a couple biblical principles about nations. First of all, there's only one chosen nation in history. God chose ancient Israel to be the bearers of the good news of the one true God. And aren't you glad from ancient Israel came our Messiah, Jesus Christ? And then we get to be joined with believers in Jesus, Jew and Gentile, rich and poor, and we're one great family called the church that expanded Israel. And we praise God that we're part of that family. Now, the nations of our world, be they ethnic groups, be they small or large political entities, the nations are blessed or judged depending upon how they respond to the truth of God. So I want to say this. America has been a blessed nation because of humble believers serving God. But America is not a chosen nation above others. We're not even in the Bible. Sorry. No, we're in the Bible as either the nation that will say yes to the Lord or tragically say no. I don't know about you, I'm holding out that we'll say yes again and that God will bring an awakening and a revival to our land. So I want us to have the humility to understand the goodness of God in our nation has also been seen in other nations as well. I was just with sisters and brothers, as I mentioned, from around the world, and they're talking about how their nation's been blessed by God to bless the other nations of the world, and I did a happy dance with them. You don't really want to see me dance or clap, I assure you. In fact, a little secret I haven't told the other two services, in all the churches where I've been a pastor, they said, please watch Pastor Charlie clap and do the opposite, okay? So I just lift my hands to the Lord. But God has been blessing our land. So let's look at the scripture together. It'll be up on the screen. And I'd like you to read it with me. When the righteous prosper, the city rejoices. When the wicked perish, there are shouts of joy. Through the blessing of the upright, a city is exalted. But by the mouth of the wicked, it is destroyed. God, honor your word and your work in history today as we learn together in order to live well for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The hand of God in history is pretty amazing. God's blessings and judgments are part of his sovereign ordering of history toward the fullness of his kingdom. As we see God's hand, we can better align with Jesus in fulfilling God's mission of bringing the gospel to all nations. Can I give you good news if you love Jesus today? We are going to be with him forever. Amen? By the way, I want you to give an example. Every semester I have new graduate students and they're always worried about their grades. And what if I told all my students, just show up and you'll pass the class? Woo! Well, they have good integrity. A few would do the work. But can I give you the good news? The gospel literally is, would you believe in Christ with all your heart and turn to him, and you are headed for heaven. Amen? But the quality of life between now and then has to do with whether we trust and obey, as Pastor David said. And so we can literally make our world a better place with our prayers, with our evangelization, with our good service. So I want to look at God's hand in our history, and let's begin with a really fun story. Many of you who've been in the States for a while know about Thanksgiving and the Pilgrims. What we may not know is that as these devout Christians persecuted in England, exiled to Holland briefly, went back to England and got permission to start a small colony. This small band of folks who loved God were met on the shores of what is today Massachusetts by a Native American and indigenous man named Squanto who spoke their language and knew the gospel. Now, can you imagine? You don't know what to expect fully. Fishermen had been there. You knew there were going to be other tribes and people, but you have no clue what to fully expect. And it was a really rough passage. It's going to be a rough time. And you're met with somebody who looks completely different than you do and says, "Hi, y'all." It's that jarring. Well, his story is a sermon by itself. Taken captive by English traders, sold into slavery in Spain, makes his way to a monastery where the brothers treat him with dignity, and he first learns the basics of the Christian faith, makes his way back to England, and a kind fisherman brings him back to the shores of this land where most of his people are gone. And yet he greets these new settlers, and his peacemaking and his survival skills enabled them to be rooted and established. And for almost two generations, there was peace in that territory. I would call that the hand of God. And just a couple years after meeting the pilgrims, Squanto's on his deathbed and requested that many pray with him so that he would have full assurance that he was going to see Jesus. What a wonderful story. What a wonderful story of God working in and through difficult circumstances. And again, I'm just going to sidetrack for a moment. There are many of us in the sound of my voice, both here and perhaps listening, and your circumstances are inexplicable. They are hard. They are difficult. God wants you to know not every circumstance is God's will. Not everything happening he is making happen, but he is present with you in that storm, and he will see you through, and he will make you strong in and through the challenges that you're facing. That's the God that we serve, and that's the blessing the pilgrims discovered. Same time frame in history, a few hundred miles south, in Virginia, the opposite was occurring. And we see God's heartache as slavery comes to Virginia in 1619. In fact, after 10 years of struggling at Jamestown, one of the leaders of the colony said they had started a church. They were concerned for, you know, missionary work. They wanted to do things. He said, "Forget about your souls, grow tobacco." Tobacco was a cash crop. In fact, it was cash in the colonies. Anybody heard of the King James Bible in history? That small little influence in English literature? Well, the same king wrote against tobacco and how unhealthy it was. But it didn't matter to these colonists. It was the key to their cash. But in order to work the fields, they started 246 years of chattel slavery in North America. Folks, we have to own that history. Not in the sense of a personal guilt today, but in the sense of humility and understanding. Just a few hundred miles north, indigenous and white folks are getting along under the banner of the cross, and down in Virginia, an entire people group are in chains serving the material needs of the settlers. Virginia is going to be a paradox. It's from Virginia some of the greatest political thinkings ever come. From Thomas Jefferson, the great General Washington, our first president, came from Virginia. Madison, others, amazing people. And yet, the pernicious evil of slavery was there. Well, this is about God's hand, not only God's heartache. Let me give you some good news. In other colonies, we see something unique in world history, and that's God's hand in the freedom of religion. Can we just be thankful today that we're free to worship? Oh, there may be some people looking in that don't like us. We're just going to pray for them and bless them. Amen? But we're free. Well, this was part of our colonial heritage. Rhode Island was established as a sanctuary. A lot of Baptists settled in Rhode Island. Maryland was a sanctuary for English Catholics. Lord Baltimore established that. And by the way, it was not only a Catholic sanctuary, but other faiths or people of no faith could settle there freely. Several Jewish synagogues were established there. Most persecuted people in history have been our Jewish neighbors and our ancestors in the faith through Abraham, and they found refuge in several colonies in North America. The story of Pennsylvania, William Penn, the king owed his father a great debt and repaid it by allowing William Penn to start the colony that becomes Pennsylvania and found the city of Philadelphia. Help me out here, the city of brotherly love until it comes to sports, right? Philadelphia actually has a beautiful history in its first 100 years or so, and then kind of needs revival, of course. But the treaty established between William Penn and the indigenous tribes is the only one not broken in American history. Just an extraordinary moment. Delaware was another such colony. Scandinavian Lutherans, people from what is today Norway, Sweden, a couple of Finns perhaps, but mostly Norway and Sweden and Denmark, Dutch Reformed, English Quakers, Welsh Baptists. It almost sounds like a joke as you go into a restaurant, but folks, they all settled peaceably and were able to practice their faith. And then the Moravians, part of Count Zinzendorf's community in Central Europe, made their way to our shores, and they were the most successful missionaries to the Native Americans. And so you have these pockets and these moments of a great heritage. And can I give you good news? When we want for all others the rights we want for ourselves, everyone flourishes. How many of you know the gospel holds up just fine? And in the competition of ideas. And folks, as we pray for America, we're not praying for an imposed theocracy. We're praying for righteousness from Jesus Christ to come and rule in the hearts and minds of everyone. Amen? Well, there's also God's heartache of so many broken covenants. There were great blessings as missionaries came up the Huron tribes in Canada, and Jesuit missionaries, Protestant missionaries in North America. There were wonderful missionaries that learned the language, led people to Christ, discipled, and allowed the indigenous folks to become fully Christian in their context. But there were so many others that even though they named the name of Jesus, they drove the indigenous out, feeling them inferior. And so the brokenness of covenants. But here's what's amazing. Whether it's Virginia and slavery or whether it's the settlers who did not respect the indigenous, can I give you the good news? The gospel got to the oppressed and began to liberate them as well. And millions of slaves became Christians and prayed for the day of their liberation. And thousands of indigenous, or we call Native American tribes, became Christians and established churches in spite of the oppression. God's kingdom goes forward. How many of you are praising God with me that since 1950, there's 100 million new Christians in China, even after communism took over in the mainland? It's just an amazing story. God's grace can break through. Well, how else has God been at work? Are you glad for spiritual revivals and spiritual awakenings? From the 1730s to the 1820s, God graciously blessed America with many revivals, some significant awakenings, hearing the cries of people who for two generations asked for the Holy Spirit to be poured out. Men like John and Charles Wesley, who started the Methodist movement. Men like Jonathan Edwards and George Whitefield, Gilbert Tennant, other great preachers. People of every denomination coming to faith. And not only coming to faith, but putting their faith to work. You can go later to the Cane Ridge Revival in Kentucky or Charles Finney's work in New York. So many great awakenings during this period of time. And here's what's really interesting. In these awakenings, probably about 1/8 of the colonial and early American population were converted. It would be the equivalent of 30 to 40 million people coming to Christ in America in the next 2 or 3 years. How many of you know that's what I'm praying for? that God would pour out his Spirit again and bring people to a faith in Christ, to an encounter with his love. Now, revival is wonderful. People ask me all the time, Pastor Charlie, are you praying for revival? And sometimes I get a little bit cheeky and I say, no, I'm praying for awakening. I hope we're all viving. Do we need revival this morning? I hope you're all viving. But what we need is to be renewed and refreshed so that we bring awakening. We take this gospel to work, to government, to the arts, to media, to compassion. We take this gospel wherever we are. And may I say to you, sisters and brothers, there's no secular work for the Christian. Amen? Everywhere we go, it's made holy by the presence of Jesus. Now, we're not imposing our faith. It's voluntary. We're not preaching at the wrong time. Please don't slam a huge Bible down and start preaching at the wrong time at the office. But we are praying and sharing and doing good and looking for divine appointments. And we want our ethics to be the highest they can be. We want our classrooms to again echo the values. We want God to be at work. And from these awakenings came missionary movements, reform movements, and transformation in our culture. We see God's hand in the founding of the American nation herself, not only the Declaration of Independence, but after our Articles of Confederation just didn't work very well to hold us together after the Revolution, our founders and framers came back together to put a new constitution together. And as they were literally praying and working, a woman asked Ben Franklin, "What kind of government do we have, Dr. Franklin?" And he replied, "A republic, madam, if you will have it." Our founders understood that without virtue, you can't have freedom. Without a moral and religious people, the liberties can turn to license, and that license to anarchy and anarchy to new forms of oppression. We need a virtuous people to be able to exercise responsibility. Our Constitution has democratic elements, but the USA is a representative republic or a representative government protecting the rights of the majority and minority. And it's a unique moment in history. Now, English common law was part of this. Our founders and framers studied 30 major forms of government all the way back to ancient Greece and Rome. They studied the Iroquois Confederacy. They studied English common law. They studied other governments. And they framed something unique for the world. And the greatest gift of all were the first 16 words of our First Amendment. The first time ever in history that we have no national church. How many of you are glad we have freedom of speech and assembly? Amen? Freedom of press. But the first freedom is in those first 16 words. Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of a religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. I know it's old-fashioned language. Put simply, no state church and no interference in any religious community that wants to flourish. It had never been done before. All other nations that had toleration still had a state church. And America gave a unique gift to the world. And I think we need to celebrate that. That's why America has not followed in all the ways of Europe and other places, because her religious communities don't have state subsidies. We have some favor with the government, but we're not funded by the government. We're not controlled by the government. It's a free market of religious opportunity. And that's why people of all faiths and none. How many of you are glad for many wonderful gospel churches we have? And of course, in American history, we've also had a few unique cults, haven't we? A little bit of both. But it comes with that territory. Now, we see God's hand and heartache in a civil war. More soldiers died in the American Civil War than in all other wars American soldiers had been in. Revolutionary, 1812, wars against, sadly, the Native Americans, World War I, World War II, Spanish-American War before that, Korea, Vietnam, Gulf Wars, other interventions. You can add them all up, and you will not reach the bloodshed of our civil war. At the beginning, it was said we need to preserve the Union. And by the ending, Abraham Lincoln understood it was God's hand of judgment and grace, God's hand of discipline for the 3 centuries of slavery, and God's hand of liberation to make a change. And out of the ashes and difficulties of this horrific war came the amendments to our Constitution that ended slavery forever. But it took another century to lift all the restrictions on the ability both of African Americans and of other minority groups to vote and fully participate in our world. And so churches themselves divided along racial lines. Southern and Northern fill in the denomination. And in my lifetime, it started to be healed. Can we thank God that it started to be healed? What do you say we accelerate the healing? What do you say we say welcome to every nation, tongue, and tribe? Look around. Isn't this an amazing family we're part of? What do you say we give God praise for this family right now? Would you give him praise? Look around. This would not have been the norm 75 to 100 years ago. God, the Holy Spirit's been at work, hasn't he? Bringing us all together in Jesus' name. And by the way, we could talk about Ellis Island and the immigrants that made our nation great, but we also have to be honest about Angel Island and the restrictions on Chinese, Japanese, and Korean immigration that existed from the 1880s to the 1940s. We have to understand the restrictions on Jewish immigration during the Nazi era, where all of Europe and all of the Western Hemisphere closed their doors to millions of people. But how many of you know there's an open door in the name of Jesus? And that open door has happened. Now, we have lots of work to do on all of these issues, but I want you to know we have a great history of welcoming, and we sometimes have a hard history of closing doors. And in all of it, we see God's hand and God's goodness. We see movements toward justice where godly women and men touched by the gospel have led the way in justice for the oppressed. Abolition, women's suffrage. By the way, all of the women who met in New York in the 1850s, all of the women who worked all the way up to 1920 to get the vote, the vast, vast majority of them were godly family women who went to church and they did their work in the name of Jesus. Immigration, child labor, working conditions, education. How many of you, you don't have to raise hands or you can jump up and down either way, but how many of you benefited from Bible studies and Sunday school classes in your lifetime? Amen? We have great ones here. Sunday school started with an English leader in the 1790s. Welcoming the poor children from the factories. You see, they worked 6 days a week, 12 to 15 hours a day, and could not go to school. And he said, this is wrong. They need the gospel, and they need to learn how to read. And Sunday school started with teaching them how to read with the Bible. And it's had a cascading effect ever since. If you like your ketchup, you could read the story of Heinz. And he founded factories for fresh food, for clean working environments, for immigrants that could rise, for women and men that could be in management, and he was a Sunday school evangelist around the world. In spite of all the systems, God's at work. In the last century, we've seen some heartache, haven't we, with so much human rebellion in our land. The long march of Marxism, in spite of the fall of the wall, in spite of so many problems, that insidious philosophy, and I'm going to be unapologetic. Christians can disagree about how much or how little government. They can disagree with how much or how little taxes. But folks, there is nothing good about a materialist philosophy that hates Judaism and Christianity. There's nothing good about a philosophy that classifies people only according to economic status and doesn't see their potential. And this it keeps making its way. We have sexual license and gender anarchy. I had no clue in my lifetime I'd have to clarify what male and female mean. We have post-Christian intellectual arrogance. For many people, many in my own family, they think Christianity belongs in the ash heap of history. Charlie, how can you be so smart and believe this superstitious nonsense? And my answer is, it's not superstitious nonsense, it's Jesus. He's the source of all wisdom and knowledge. But we've replaced the Almighty God with an altar to ourselves. The new Tower of Babel is that we can invent ourselves and keep reinventing ourselves. Folks, we're made in God's image. From conception to coronation, our lives are in his hands, and we belong to him. And Jesus loved us so much, he'd rather die than live without us. And on that cross made a way for us to know our real identity and our real purpose. Individualism becomes hedonism. When I was growing up and figuring out my work in the world, I didn't know that people were going to make a living as social influencers. Now, I'm not against YouTube. I enjoy going on and seeing what people are doing and thinking. But my goodness, I've just never seen such hedonism in my life. Look at me, look at me, look at me. Now, look, I know I have the wrong name for a preacher, okay? So just live with it, okay? You've all been self-taught today, right? By the way, I actually had a student that when I was taught at Bethany years ago, his last name was Sinner. He changed his name in order to get a job as a pastor. So it can even go that way too, can it? But folks, can we just, we see these things, but I got to give you the good news. We know the problems, and we're unafraid here at Church of the Highlands to address those. But I just got to say, in the last century, we've not only had the long march of Marxism, sexual license, these problems. But what do you say? We start rejoicing. We've had the greatest outpourings of the Spirit and the greatest missionary activity in Christian history in the last century. Praise God for his movement. Some of you, this may be a new name, but I still have the voice of Billy Graham in my head. What a great evangelist. I listened to his last sermon preparing for this one, and I looked around when I was listening. I need a place to go forward and get saved again. But he was just one among hundreds of amazing women and men bringing the gospel to our world, and we thank God for the fact that we have more Christians than ever before in our world. Global population's gone up 5 times in a century, and we've kept pace with it. We need to do better, but we've kept pace with it. And now the majority of real Christians around the world are now re-evangelizing the West. America and Europe sent missionaries for 200 years around the world, and now in the last 100 years, missionaries have started to come back to us. Praise his holy name. Are you glad for the Jesus revolution and charismatic renewals? This church embraced the gospel, the timeless gospel, and openness to the Spirit and openness to every culture. Aren't you glad we can come as we are and find the grace of Jesus Christ? I'll give you a story from this, from San Jose. About 20 years ago, I was on a church staff there, and we're dressed fairly formally for Sunday morning. But I was out in the parking lot just checking on things in between services. And a gentleman came up dressed in shorts and a polo shirt, and he looked at me and said, "Do I have to dress like that to come to your church?" And I turned to him and I said, "Don't tell anybody, it's just for the old people." That morning he came to Christ. Now, folks, it's fine to present ourselves well. But aren't you glad we can say to anyone and everyone, "Come, drink of the water of life without price." And this is what the Jesus Revolution did. And the songs we sang today with all the instruments and the beauty of that are the fruit of this. And Church of the Highlands said yes to people of every culture and class, to people of every background. Come, meet Jesus. Come, walk in the Spirit, trusting in God's word with us, and things will change. And now we're being evangelized by the rest of the world. Let me share God's heart for us today. I am so happy to be living right now. Oh, I'm not happy with every circumstance. Am I the only one that a few politicians say things and I cringe? I'm not happy with all of the sin and rebellion, but I am happy that God has placed me in his church in this moment, which must mean he wants to use us for his glory. We're godly exiles in an empire, in a world where empires are colliding right now. Are you ready for the Lord's return? Come on now. Our pastors have been teaching us that he's coming, and he's coming soon. Yeah, get excited. Get excited and ask for one more day so someone can come to Christ. I want us to expect the Lord's return, and I want us to plant trees. I want us to live in light of his soon return and trust him today to reach another person for Christ. Our intercession and integrity can change neighborhoods and nations. I wish I could take you to Houston and Massachusetts and Washington State and Virginia right now and tell you that, like our church here this morning, there are local churches making a difference in their neighborhoods. People are flourishing, coming to Christ because of the faithfulness of God's people. We need to love our country. We need to love our country and love God's kingdom even more. In fact, the more we love God's kingdom, the more we can love our nation with our prayers and our good works and our proclamation of the truth. So before we pray in a commissioning prayer and go from this place, I want to share just some practical steps forward. And they've already been shared in song and in communion. And we didn't even compare notes, but the Spirit did. Number one, we begin with prayer. As our hearts change, our pleas change the world. God's decided to use our prayers to make a difference in the world. I want to end all fatalism this morning. Now, God's going to bring history to his ordained end. Amen? But he invites us to participate with him in prayer and in mission. Our prayers make a difference. Now, my late father-in-law worked at a tech company down on 101, down in Sunnyvale area, and they had a couple young guys there called the Dolby Brothers, who were just asked for their own laboratory. The company said no, and the rest is history. Dolby's done okay, if you've ever been in a surround sound theater. By the way, the other company is just a sign on 101. It doesn't exist. But I told God one day, just put a Dolby speaker in the heavens and a 7D TV and tell the world to repent. It would be so much more efficient. And God said, no, I've decided to use your halting speech, the good works of your hands, and the prayers of your heart to make a difference. We walk in obedience to the word and joyful expectation of the Spirit's work. We stand for truth with tears, blessing those that oppose us. We're going to be in an intense period between now and the election and even after the election. Folks, this is a critical moment in our history. So many of our institutions are tottering, and our dear brother mentioned we're under attack spiritually, financially. We're under attack morally. We're under attack relationally. Folks, it's a critical moment. We have to stand for truth, but we do it with humility and tears, calling people to faith in Jesus Christ. How many of you know somebody prayed for us and we embraced Jesus Christ? We were far away and Christ brought us near. And finally, we unite with all gospel believers to see divine blessings. Are you glad that there are other congregations that love Jesus as well? What do you say we fill all of them with people praising God and commissioned to go and make a difference in our world? Amen? God's divine hand has been amazing in our history. I could tell you stories of Sister Clara Brown, the Queen of the Rockies, a freed slave who shook the gold dust out of miners' jeans, bought her first piece of property, and ended up planting the first Protestant church in the Rockies, the first old age home, and owned 30 pieces of property when she died. Don't ever say God can't take little and make it much. Tell you the story of the citrus fruit you enjoy from a Chinese Baptist immigrant in Florida who created oranges that would survive the frost. God's hand has been in our history. And what do you say we now receive his commission today as we go in Jesus' name? Would you just open your hearts, bow your heads, and receive his blessing? May God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, the one who dwells in the highest of heavens and with the humble of heart, May his embrace touch you today. And may your cry of Abba, Father, come by the Spirit of God. May you bow before his almighty power and may you receive his unconditional affection. May Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who calls you friend, bless you, strengthen you, and show you the mission in front of you each day. And may the sovereign Spirit of God, who raised Jesus from the dead and lives in our mortal bodies, may the Holy Spirit grant you wisdom, strength, power, grace to carry out God's work in the world. May the Lord bless and commission you today to be in the power of His Spirit and in the compassion of His love. See God bring awakening to our land. Father, we pray your mercy upon our land. We have such hope because of history. We believe you can do it again. In Jesus' name we pray. Would you say amen? Amen. God bless you. We'll see you next week.